Hello, and welcome to the course of Indian History presented to you by Plus Prameshi Library. So here we are covering Tamil Nadu Class 11th and Class 12th books, and this particular lesson is for Tamil Nadu Class 11. So here is the mentor for the course, Supriya Singhal. You can read about me more from here, or you can follow me on Instagram by the name of Crispy Stories. So let's begin with the next unit in the series that we are already done with unit 4 units, okay, and which is basically unit 5. So before I start with the unit 5, you must know that in history we have already done, okay, the North Indian history, especially of the ancient times, okay. So we have not yet reached medieval, we have only covered ancient till now, and in ancient also You must remember that we have covered a chronological series. Okay, we started from prehistoric times of Paleolithic, Mesolithic, Neolithic, basically the old stone ages. Then we went on to the protohistoric time or the Chalcolithic period or the Harappan civilization, or also called as the Indus Valley civilization. After that we moved towards the Vedic age, which had Rig Vedic age also, and the later Vedic age also. After Vedic age, we studied about the 600 BC, and I told you what was important about that particular year, that it led to the rise of Buddhism and Jainism within India, it led to rise of Zoroastrianism outside India, and also it was the rise of the Mahajanapadas during this period. After that, what we studied was that there were four Mahajanapadas, but in the end, finally, who survives? It was Magad. And then we started with the chronology of Magad. So then we kept our area as same. Okay, and then we saw how many dynasties came and went. So the first dynasty that came was Haryanaka, then came the Saisungas, then came the Nandas, then came the Mauryas, then came the Sungas, then came the Kanvas, then came the Kushans. So Sungas and Kanvas, okay, till here it is fine. Now after Sungas and Kanvas, you will find that the empire has basically become short because of the invasions. And then we studied about the invasions happening also, like Bactrians, Scythians, then Parthians and Kushans. Okay, after this, we also studied, then came the empire of Guptas, and finally after Gupta came the Harsha. So this was the chronology that we followed in the upper side, in the North Indian side. Also, we saw here itself the rule of Satvahans, and also in southern India, we saw the basically three, the Sangam ages, which was Chola, Cheras and Pandyas. Okay, apart from Satvahans, we also saw after Satvahans, here came the Chalukyas, because we saw constant struggle between Harsha and Chalukyas. Okay, so this much we have done till now, and I'm hoping that you must have completed all the units before you proceed. So now we will proceed with the southern Indian kingdoms, because northern Indian ancient history is still Harsha Empire, okay, or Pushyabhuti dynasty in the southern India, but we are left with many things. We are left with Pallavas and like so on. We are left with Imperial Cholas. So we'll try covering them in greater detail here. Okay, so first we will start with the Pallavas, which is the South Indian Kingdom 1, as you can see here. It is the lesson number 11, unit number 5 of Tamil Nadu class 11th. Okay, so what is happening is, see, in southern India, so we studied about the Sangam age, and we saw that the roughly the years of Sangam ages might be around minus 200 BC to somewhere around 200 AD, okay, or 300 AD. We don't have an exact idea that this is the year when Sangam age started or it ended, but we know roughly the time, because we can actually find the contemporaries of the kings that ruled in the Sangam age. Okay, so now after 300 AD, the first kingdom that was established in South India, basically after Chelas, Cholas and Pandyas, was Kingdom of Pallavas. And Pallavas is a very, very important topic for your art and culture perspective. Okay, so after the decline of Sangam age in Tamil country, as we saw, the Kalabra rule lasted for about 250 years. Okay, and after the Kalabra rules came the Pallavas. So Pallavas established their kingdom in Todai Mandalam. Now this place is important because this was asked in the state services examination. Okay, because a lot of people don't remember the names of the state capitals, especially the southern Indian kingdoms, so you need to remember it. So what are we saying? We are saying that Pallavas started their rule from basically Todai Mandalam, okay, and the capital was Kanchipuram. Okay, and we already know, see, Pallavas will be somewhere here, okay, and the capital will be somewhere, like capital will be, let me just draw it again, so here, and capital will be somewhere here. Okay, So now you have their rule continued till Todaimandaram was captured and annexed by the imperial Cholas. As I told you that Pallavas, after that also came few rulers, but after that came the imperial Cholas. So you can say that Pallavas might be running, and you know, obviously the empire might have shrunk, but they were still present. But finally came the imperial Cholas in around, you can say 1100 AD, and then you can say basically their rule was finished. Now we will talk about the origin of Pallavas. See, there are different views on origin of Pallavas, and like some people have said that they, you know, they were like Parthians, they were foreigners who came actually to India, especially to Western India. Then another view is that Pallava was basically a Brahmin family, royal branch, okay, of Vagatakas of the Deccan. Then there is another view which says that Pallavas basically are the descendants of the Chola prince and a Naga princess whose native was the island of Manipavlam. Okay, but I mean, see, the point is history can only only be read and studied from the angle when we know a little bit about it. Okay, but we know that Pallavas, there are only theories of origin. We don't have any adequate evidence to say that this was the view. Okay, and therefore what is happening, that it was considered like in the end that Pallavas, they might have been the natives of the Todaimandalam area itself where they actually established the empire. Okay, and they are also identical with the Pulindas who is mentioned in the inscriptions. Of Ashoka. So now you must be wondering, see, the point is you will only take that particular origin theory or that particular view which has little bit of more evidence available to it. So if you have only like books, so with that to fiction books written, you might not want to take it. But suppose if you have inscriptions mentioned somewhere, then that becomes a good source to actually ponder about it. Now when Todaimandalam was conquered by the Satavahans, Pallavas became their fiduciaries. Okay, so what is happening? There was a Satavahan empire, remember, Andhra Bhoju used to call, and within those Satavahans, like one of the fiduciaries was their Pallavas. Okay, and after the fall of Satavahans in the 3rd century AD, which is around 300 AD, basically Pallavas became independent and they started issuing their own inscriptions in Prakrit and Sanskrit, because obviously they knew how to write in it because of the Satavahan connection, and you know, they also were the patronizers of Brahmanism. So this is like a very brief history of origin, but you can definitely take what is given in NCERT as the final answer. So I will actually ask you that what do you think is the origin theory that is given in the NCERT, because you might need to read NCERT as well for Tamil Nadu for your exam. So let me know that what do you think is the origin theory. Now we come to the political history. So the early Pallava rulers from around, you can say roughly around 250 AD to 350 AD, they used to issue their charters in Prakrit. And see, why will they issue charters in Prakrit? And if you remember, we are calling them as fiduciaries of Satavahans. And Satavahans used to extensively use Prakrit as a medium for communication. Remember Hala Satsai. So that is why you will find that earlier when 250 AD to 350 AD, Pallavas are still using Prakrit as a language. Now important among them were Sivaskandavarman. So here if you find, there are two names written. One is Sivaskandavarman and one is Vijay Skandavarman. Now this Varman or Varman is basically the surname used by the Pallava rulers. So you will find that one of the Southeast Asian countries, okay, I'm not going to tell you the name because you have to tell me, they also used to have dynasties where the rulers used to adopt this surname of Varman. Okay, and this is said that they had a Pallava connection also with India. So now you need to tell me what dynasty was that. Okay, so here you will find that Pallava rulers, the important were Sivaskandavarman and Vijayaskandavarman, the second line of Pallava rulers. Okay, so basically what we are doing is we are dividing Pallava rule into lines or different phases. First is around 250 to 350 AD, okay, where we have told two important rulers. Now comes the second line, which is 350 to 550 AD. Okay, and while the first one is issuing the charters in Prakrit, the second one has started issuing charters in Sanskrit. Okay, and the most important ruler of this particular line was Vishnu Gopa. Okay, who was defeated by Samudra Gupta of the Gupta Empire during his South Indian expedition. Remember, when he fought these kings, he was so impressed that he gave them their empire back. So it is that Samudra Gupta only. Then the rulers of the third line. So after second line came the third line, who ruled from around 500 AD to last, like last in the sense, where till the time Pallava ruled, till their fall in the 9th century, and they issued the charters both in Sanskrit as well as Tamil. Extremely important. Now basically the regional language Tamil has come into picture. And here you will find that Simha Vishnu, who was the first ruler of this line, okay, he destroyed the Kalbras and he established firmly the rule of Pallavas. In which area? Todai Mandalam area. He also defeated the Cholas. And you know, see, the point is, if he's defeating the Cholas, that means that he's getting a chance to expand his empire. So that's what he did, and he expanded his empire till Kaveri. Okay, another great rulers that you should know, four great rulers that you should know of this era were Mahendravarman, Narasimhavarman, Rajasimhavarman and Narasimhavarman too. Okay, here one is missing, which is Rajasimhavarman. So that you need to remember. And how do you remember it? You basically remember it like this: Mahendravarman, Narasimhavarman, Rajasimhavarman and Narasimhavarman again. Okay, and this Narasimhavarman and this Narasimhavarman are not same. Okay, they might be like father, grandfather and children, but since they are mostly they adopt the same name, so they put one and two in front of it. Okay, so now we will take each of these Pallava rulers in little bit detail. So first we will start with the great ruler called as Mahendravarman. So now the long drawn Pallava Chalukya conflict. Okay, so what is happening? See, I have told you, first of all, what is happening, that Changamage has died and then there came the Pallavas. Now Pallavas basically are in three stages. Now this is the time when third line of defense has started, and now we are talking about Mahendravarman. Now that time what is happening, there is Pallavas here, then there is Chalukyas here, and above Narmada you will find there is whom here? There is Harsha, because this is the time of 600 AD. So there is Harsha in the north, Chalukyas in the central area, and then Pallavas in the south. And that is why you will find that this is the time when Chalukyas are fighting with Harsha also, and they are fighting with Pallavas also. So there was a Pallava Chalukya conflict that began during this period. Pulakesin II, remember the Chalukyan king Pulakesin II, whose court poet was Ravi Kirti, and he actually wrote about the Harsha and Pulakesin II war, and he said Harsha was no longer Harsha. So same Pulakesin II, he marched against the Pallavas. Okay, he captured the northern part of the kingdom. Although a Pallava inscription refers to the victory of Mahendravarman, that we saw with Harsha also, that their pillar referred to the victory of Harsha. Here also something like that is happening, and the pillar is basically located in Pulalur. But he was still not able to recover the lost territory. Okay, Mahendravarman was the follower of Jainism in the early part of his career, but he was then converted to Shaivism by some Shaiva saint, whose name is Thiruvannupurasar, alias Appar. Now this Appar is very very famous. If you know, then you know there are two kinds of, you can say, see, actually you should remember that bhakti, that cult bhakti that we say, na, bhakti cult started wherein people started saying that everybody could achieve salvation, you need to be an ardent devotee of the God, you need to sing, you need to dance, you need to actually, you know, devote yourself to the God, and this is how you might basically actually achieve nirvana, what we call enlightenment. Now this bhakti cult was started in around, you know, you can say 800 AD or something, in what? It was started in Tamil area only, okay, Tamil Nadu only. So we say basically bhakti cult started in India from Tamil Nadu, and slowly it moved up, okay, it moved west, it moved east, it moved center, and it went till Kashmir. So this has been the movement of bhakti cult, or bhakti, you can say bhakti tradition in India. Okay, now why am I telling you this? Because in Tamil Nadu there were two kinds of bhakti saints, okay. One was the group, there were two groups basically. One was the group which was ardent devotee of Shiva, and other was the group who was ardent devotee of Krishna. Okay, so Shiva ones were called as Nayanars, and Krishna ones were called as Alvars. Okay, so what are they called? Alvars, and Shiva ones are called as the Nayanars. Okay, so now what is happening, Mahendravarman is basically an ardent devotee of Shaivism now, and the Seva saint, okay, called as Appar. So Appar is a very famous Nayanar, and Appar basically you will find Thirunavukkarasar is the name of Appar, basically the real name, but I don't think that this has been asked. What has been asked is Appar only. So now Appar basically will convince Mahendravarman to convert to Shaivism. Now he built a Shiva temple also at Tiruvadi, and he assumed a number of titles like Gunabhra, Satyasandha, Chittagadi, because he was the builder of temples, and then Chitrakarapuli, and then Vichitra Chitta, and Matta Vilasa. Okay, he was a great builder of cave temples and that is why he was called as a Chetakari. Okay, the Manda Gapatu inscription hails as him as a Vichitra Chetta. Now Vichitra Chetta is important because Vichitra means what? Vichitra means someone that can astonish you, right? And Chitta means that you have actually drawn something. That means you can draw or you can produce things which are like very, you know, which can actually surprise people. So that is why he used to call me as Vichitra Chitta. So now you will find that he's already called Chetakari because he can build a lot of temples and he built a lot of cave temples. And why cave temples am I telling you? Because if you remember in your art and culture course, you might have studied the Dravida style of architecture. In that you would have studied Dravida style of temple making. And in that you must have studied that Pallavas were the first who started this Dravida style of temple making, but it reached its climax during the imperial Cholas. Now in Pallavas also, if you remember, what they used to do was, suppose this is a rock, okay, in that rock, now what they will do, first they will build a cave, and this is what Mahendravarman did, okay. After Mahendravarman came Ratsivarman, who actually give the shape to the rock, okay, like this. He did not do much about it. Then the Narsivarman first. Then Ratsivarman was the first who actually, you know, started making, constructing like big, big temples like this. And then there was pyramid, there was walls, and there was big, big walls. So this was Ratsivarman. And then after that, you'll find that again smaller temples are started. So that is why I'm saying that Mahendravarman is actually only building cave temples. He's not building the proper temples. And to build cave temples also, he's called as Chetakari. And he's also called as Vichitra Chetta, who constructed a temple of Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva without the use of bricks, timber, metal and mortar. Now tell me, without any of these, how will you like build a temple? But he did that, and that is why people used to call him Vichitra Chetta. Okay, his rock cut temples are found in number of places like Vallam, Dalavanur, Pallavaram, Mandagapattu, Tiruchupilli, etc. He had also authored a Sanskrit work called as Matta Vilasa Prahasanam. Now this is important because this might be asked in your examination. So what is the book name that has been authored by the Mahendravarman? It was Matta Vilasa Prahasanam, and his title Chitra Karapuli reveals his talents in painting. Okay, so already builder of temples, builder of Vichitra temple, and then basically painter, which is called as a Chitra Karapuli. He's also regarded as an expert in music. Remember, Samudragupta used to play Veena. Similarly, you will find that even this particular ruler, Mahendravarman I, is also very multi-dimensional, multi-talented. Okay, the music inscription we have found is that Kudiyan Malai, which is ascribed to him. So this is all about the Mahendravarman, who is the, you can say, third line of defense wala Pallava rule ka, like very important ruler. Now we have the second ruler, which is the Narsivarman I, which is who is ruling from 630 to around 688 AD. Now Narsivarman I was also known as Mamala, which means that a great wrestler. He wanted to take the, what is happening, we know that Chalukyas and Pallavas, they are in constant struggle, okay. And there was a, a battle or a war between Pulakesin II and Mahendravarman. And we know that Pulakesin II won that war, who was from Chalukyas. So now Mahendravarman's son is actually wanting to take a revenge of his father's defeat. Okay. And what he does is, basically his victory over the Pulakesin II in the battle of Manimangalam near Kanji is mentioned in the Kurram copper plates. Okay. That means what? It is telling you that Narsivarman I went on a war with the Pulakesin II, he defeated him and he got it inscribed in the copper plates. Okay. The Pallava army under the general Pranjyoti, okay, Paranjyoti, pursued the retreating Chalukyan army. It entered the Chalukyan territory also. They captured also, they destroyed their capital city of Vatapi. And we know that Chalukyas of basically Badami and Chalukyas of Vatapi, like they are the same basically, okay. Chalukyas from the basically the same region and present nearby. So Vatapi was the capital. Similarly, Pallavas of Kanchipuram. Okay. So now Narsivarman I assumed the title of Vatapi Konda. And why will he call as a Vatapi Konda? Because he was the one who destroyed the Vatapis. He was the one who destroyed the Chalukyans. And he basically regained his lost territory, what his father lost to Chalukyas. Okay, another important achievement of Narsivarman would be that he sent a naval expedition to Sri Lanka and he restored the throne of his friend and Sri Lankan prince Manavarma. So that means what? He is helping basically his friend also to establish his rule in Sri Lanka. Okay, Now, during his reign, you will find that Yuanzhang, because we know that Yuanzhang was there around 630-635 AD. So, Yuanzhang has come to the court of Harsha. But his reign is the one where Yuanzhang has also visited the Pallava capital, Kanchipuram. That tells you that Yuanzhang was not only present in Harsha's court, he kept traveling. And that is why he even went to the Pallava capital, Kanchipuram. Okay, and he describes Kanchi very vividly. Okay, he calls it big and beautiful city with 6 miles in circumference. It had 100 Buddhist monasteries also, in which 10,000 Buddhist monks used to live. And according to his account, the people of Kanchi established or esteemed the great learning and the Ghatikas at Kanchi. See, Ghatikas is the place where you used to study. So you will find that Kanchipuram has become a very educational hub, okay, where a lot of Ghatikas have gotten established, and it has become now a great center of learning. Okay, now Narsivarman I was the founder of Mamallapuram and another monolithic ruts, okay, which were erected during his reign. Now, but the greatest ruts, you can see what is happening. I already told you there's like cave temple starting, like wherein there is a rock. Suppose if there is a rock like this, you will just make a cave inside it, and this will be called as a rock cut temple, which was built by Mahendravarman. After came his son Narsimhavarman, which basically said, okay, fine, let me just give it shape, okay, and he built, basically these were called as ruts, monolithic ruts, because they were made from the one stone. Okay, monolithic ruts, which means monolithic, which means one stone. So one stone ruts basically like this, and here you will find that in Narsivarman range, okay, you might find five paths, rath, okay, which are also called as the five Pandav rath, and there will be smaller than Draupadi rath also, okay. Now, after him came the Rajasimha, who was there from 695 to 772 AD. So, Narsivarman I was succeeded by the Mahendravarman II and Parmeswaram I, and the Pallava Chalukya conflict continued during this range also. And thereafter, you will find that Narsivarman II took the throne. And he was also called as the Rajasimha. His region was very, like you can say, his reign was very peaceful. And he also got a lot of time to develop art and architecture. See, if you are only coming, first of all, for a short period of time, secondly, if you are coming for a long period of time, but you are just only fighting, then what will happen? In both the cases, you won't get time to actually devote to other activities of the kingdom like culture, art, architecture, etc. But suppose if you have a stable rule, if you are basically coming for a long period of time, then you get time in your hand only to basically start asking for construction in your empire. Okay, the Shore Temple, please remember it. What is it? The Shore Temple at Mamallapuram and Kailasnath Temple at Kanchipuram, they were built during this period. And why was Mamallapuram in news? Mamallapuram was in news because there was a second India-China informal summit that took place in this place recently, at 2019. Now, he was also a great patron of art and letters, and the famous Sanskrit scholar Dandin is said to have adorned his court. Okay, so this is very important, because if a king is there and if he is adorning such beautiful elements, okay, such like experts in the field, then obviously it becomes important for us to remember them. Now, he sent embassies also to China, and the maritime trade flourished during his reign. Rajasimha, or the Rajasimha, he assumed the titles like Sankar Bhakta, okay, Vaidya Vidhara, and Agampriya. Now, these titles you might not find very easy to learn. I'll just say, just read them once, because I mean, it's very hard to remember, if especially when you already have like Mahendravarman's title also. Okay, and he, like this Rajasimha will be succeeded by his own son Parmeswaram II and Nandivarman II. Okay, and the Pallava rule will last till the end of 9th century AD. And Chola King Aditya I was the one who defeated the last Pallava ruler, okay, Aparajita, and he seized the Kanchi kingdom. So the last Pallava ruler is Aparajita, who was defeated by the Chola King, okay, and Aditya I, and finally the Kanchipuram and the Kanchi area was seized, okay, by the Cholas. And with this, once their capital is also gone, we say that the rule of Pallava dynasty or rule came to an end. Okay. Now we will study about the administration of Pallavas. So Pallavas, just like the other empires, they also had a well-organized administrative system. Okay, so there was like a big Pallava state. It was divided in kotams. Okay, and the kotams were, see, kotams are the biggest units, okay, of an empire. And these are basically run, or you can say, oversight by the government officers who are appointed by the king. And the king was at the center of administration. So there was going to be king. Then king will appoint officers for each of these kotams. okay, and king, you will find that he is not alone ruling, but he is taking the help from a council of ministers. Okay, and king, see, king is not only the executive body here, he is also the legislative and he is also the judiciary. That means king will only resolve disputes, king will only pass laws and decrees, and king will only execute them. Okay, he also maintained a well-trained army, so we know that king is also a army man now, and he provided land grants to the temples as devadhan. Okay, so whatever like grant he is giving to the basically temples, you will find that he used to call as the devdan, and he also used to donate to Brahmins and used to call as the Brahmade. Okay, and it was the responsibility of the central government to actually provide the irrigation facilities to the lands. Okay, then, and that is why you will find that during the Pallava period, you might find that, you know, extensive digging of wells took place for irrigation, and irrigation tanks in Mahendravadi and Mammandur, they were dug during the region of Mahendravarman I. Okay, now land tax was the primary source, because already you know that agriculture is the major source of land revenue for the king also. So land tax system is also basically an important part, and it was the primary source of the government revenue, as I told you. Okay, the Brahmadi and Devdhan lands, they were exempted from the tax because you are giving them to two special entities, one for Brahmins, another for your basically construction of temples. Now traders and artisans like carpenters, goldsmiths, washermen, weavers, they also pay taxes to the government. Okay, the Pallava inscriptions throw light on the village assemblies called as Sabhas and their communities. They maintained records of all village lands that are coming under the village, and they looked after the local affairs of the village, and they also managed, they also participated and managed the temples. Okay, so this is important of how administration is divided, yet it is centralized in the king itself. Now we will study about the society under Pallavas. Okay, so the Tamil society witnessed a great change during the Pallava period. The caste system, which was earlier not rigid, it became very, very rigid. The now when caste system has become rigid, obviously the importance of Brahmins will be high. So we know there are Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. Shudras condition will become pathetic, and Brahmins condition will basically rise day by day. Okay, so Brahmins, as you already know, they were given land grants called as Brahmade by king and nobles both. They were also given the responsibility of looking after the temples. Now Pallava period also saw the rise of Shaivism, because we know that one of the rulers also converted to Shaivism. And similarly, you will find that later Pallavas, okay, they converted to Vaishnavism, and hence you will find Vaishnavism was also rise in this empire. Now since Hunsang visited this empire, that means that there was a significant Buddhism also present here. So that means Buddhists are also here. And Jainism, we already know that when famine struck in the North Indian region, under the Bhadrabahu, some people actually went to Shravanbelgola, okay, which is in Karnataka, and this is nearby to the area that Pallavas are operating, and hence you will find this is a good combination of Jainism also. Okay, the Saiva Nayanars and the Vaishnavas Alvars, they contributed to the growth of Shaivism and Vaishnavism, and this is what I told you, but in Bhakti cult, basically when it is starting or Bhakti period, there are two things, Nayanars and Alvars, Alvars for Krishna and Nayanars for Shiva, and they both are basically contributing to the growth of Shaivism and Vaishnavism. Okay, and this is known as the Bhakti movement, which I already told you. Now they compose their hymns in Tamil language, okay, and these like, see, what are they doing? They're actually, remember Rig Veda had 1028 hymns, so those hymns were like present in the form of Sanskrit. Now here the basically hymns are in Tamil language, okay, and these hymns are basically revolving around the importance of devotion, or why you should actually, you know, follow bhakti, what you will gain out of it, all that. And the construction of temples by Pallava kings, they paved the way for basically spread of these two religions. Now we will talk about the education and literature. So the Pallavas, they were the great patrons of learning. As I told you, the capital was Kanchi or Kanchipuram, and it was the ancient center of learning. Apart from Nalanda, there is one more center in the south which acted just like Nalanda was, Kanchi. The Ghatika at Kanchi was very, very popular, as it attracted students from all over India as well as abroad. Okay, the founder of Kadamba dynasty, Mayur Sarman, he also studied Vedas at Kanchi only. Okay, then there came the Deen Ganga, who was a Buddhist writer who also studied in Kanchi. Then there was Dharampal, who later became the head of Nalanda University. He also belonged to Kanchi. Bhairavi, the greatest Sanskrit scholar. Okay, he lived in the time of Simha Vishnu, and he was also basically, you can say, present. Then Dandin, another Sanskrit writer, adorned the court of Narsivarman too. Okay, then came the Mahendravarman, who composed the Sanskrit play, which was called as Mathali Vilasa Prahasanam. Okay, this one. So now you know basically what is the that Mahendra Varman, I told you now, he is also a good writer. So he also himself wrote a Sanskrit play which is basically Matta Vilasa Prahasanam. Okay, and Tamil literature was also developed. Now Nainas and Alvars, they composed the religious hymns in Tamil because they were the Bhakti saints. Okay, and Devaram, he composed the Nainas and the Nale Driva Pravandam. And this is the book that you need to remember. So there is Nainas and there is Alvars. With Nainas there is this Devi Prabandhan book, okay, Nala Devi Prabandhan, okay, sorry. Then there is a book called as Nala Devya Prabandham, okay, which is basically for the Nainas, okay. Now, you will find that this Nala Devya Prabandham, this book has lot of information, okay, about the religious literature of the Pallava period. Then comes the Perundivanar, which was patronized by Nandi Varman too, and he translated the Mahabharat, okay, of as a Bharat Venda in Tamil. Okay, so basically what is he doing? He is actually translating the Mahabharat, which is written in some other form, to now Tamil. Now Nandi Kalabhagam was another important work that you know, the same author Perundivanar, he worked on it, okay, and music and dance also developed during this period. Now, we will move to a very, very important part of Pallava kingdom, which is the Pallava's art and architecture. So, you already have studied the, I'm assuming that you might be, you either have studied or you will have to study about the Pallava architecture in your art and culture course. Okay. And there you will start to know that Pallavas were the one who started the age of great temple building in the south. Okay. In the south, I'm saying. So, that is Dravida. So, they started it. I'm not saying that they were the one who started it. I'm saying they started it in the southern Indian like empire. Now, the Pallavas introduced the art of excavating temples from the rock. That I already discussed with you. How to excavate temples from a rock, build a cave, then give a shape, and then finally build a rath. In fact, the Dravidian style of architecture, it began from the Pallavas rule. It was a gradual evolution from the cave temples to monolithic ruts and finally to the structural temples. Okay, and that is why you will find that with each person, okay, with each ruler of the Pallava dynasty, there came some specific elements of art and architecture. So first we'll talk about the Mahendra Varman one. He introduced the rock cut temples, and this style of Pallava temples was seen at places like Mangadapattu, Mahindravadi, Mavandur, Dalavanur, Tiruchapalli, Vallam, okay, and Tiru Kalukunaram, okay. Then we have a second stage of Pallava, wherein we know that, you know, such shapes have been given. So this shape, so this Pallava, you will find that architecture is represented by the monolithic rath because it is one stone. And I basically, you will find that like Narsivarman one. So we remember there was Mahendra Varman, Narsivarman, Rajsivarman. So Narsivarman is the second ruler under whom like this particular form of architecture came around. Okay, the five rath I already told you, which was called as the Pandav rath, because Pandavs are five: Bhim, Arjun, Nakul, Sahadev, and Yudhishthir. Okay, so these are five Pandavs, and five raths are also there. They signified the five different styles of temple architecture. Okay, the Mandavs, you will find they contain beautiful sculptures on its walls, and the most popular being basically Mahisutra Mahishasur Madhini. Okay, the Mandap, then there is Trimurti Mandapam, and there is Vraha Mandapam. Now, in the next time when Ransimha is coming, okay, these temples were built by using soft land, sand rocks. And why? Because Ratsivarman was the one in whose tenure you will have finally a proper Dravida temple. Like you will have pyramid, and then you have Garbhagriha, then you have Sanctum Sanctorum, then you have basically like a corridor to move around, you have like big walls called Gopurams, and then you have temple, like you can say you have water bodies inside the temple only. So now here the Kailasna temple at Kanchi and Shore temple at Mamallapuram, okay, they became the finest examples of early structural temples of Pallavas. The Kailasna temple at Kanchi, so how do you remember it? KK, Kailasna temple of Kanchi, okay, and then Shore temple is at Mahabalipuram or Mamallapuram, okay. And this Kailasna temple, which is in Kanchi, it is the greatest architectural master of this Pallava art. Okay, and finally, after Ratsivarman, the last stage of Pallava art is also represented by structural temples only. The Vaikundam Puravel temple, Mukteshwara temple, okay, Maganteswara temple at Kanchipuram, they all belong to this age only, or this architecture style only. Then you will find that Pallavas, they also contributed to the development of sculptures. Okay, apart from sculptures found in the temples, they used to have open art gallery in Mamallapuram. Okay, and here you will find that great 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 sculptures have been made. For example, Descent of Gange. For example, Arjun's Penance. Okay, and these are basically fresco paintings done in stone. Okay, the minute you will find that they are so beautifully painted that such minute details have also been given. Okay, so like theme of these sculptures can be many things. For example, lice picking monkey, elephants of huge size, then a static cat. It can be anything. Okay, but the point is that they had sculptures which were very very beautiful in nature. Now we come to the fine arts. So the music, dance, and painting, they also developed under the patronage of Pallavas. Okay, and you will find that Mamdur inscription contains a note on the notation of vocal music also. The Kudi Banavalai inscription referred to as the musical notes and instruments. Alvars and Nayanars, they composed their hymns in various musical notes. Okay, and dance and drama also became the part of this time, especially whenever Bhakti cult has started or it is present, you will find that dance and drama is the intricate part. The Siddha Navasal paintings, okay, they belong to this period only, and the commentary called as Dakshin Chitra, it was also combined during the Mahendra Varman time, who had basically the little Chitra Karupuli. With this, we will actually done with the Pallavas. And in the next class, we will start with the another two South Indian kingdoms, which is Chalukyas and Rashtrakutas. So, ancient done, us North India and South India also, we have already done the Pallavas, Sangamage, Satvahans. Okay, and now we will start with the Chalukyas and Rashtrakutas.